Hey everybody, this is Chris and today we're going to be doing a show. I've been wanting to post this show and praying about it. This is the last deleted show that we did. We revised it and it was a show that we did with Anthony Patch, his last show. But now today I have Tim with me today to do the show. And as you know, Anthony is not going to be doing shows anymore, but he is doing well. I just talked to him yesterday and to let him know we would be doing the show, and he was fine with that. And hello, Anthony. We miss you, and just want to thank you for all that you did, all the time and energy that you spent talking about these important things. You know, Anthony did all those things for free. He gave a lot of his books away, and he's just a kind and humble friend. And we just wanted to say thank you and that we miss you too. But I'll give it over to Tim. Hey, Tim, my friend, and he can introduce the show and we'll get going with everything.
Yeah, it's good to be back with doing the end times shows that we've been doing, and we're the Watchmen watching the end with the other Watchmen watching the end to spread the end times news. And it's happy news as far as Jesus coming back, but of course we take the news as it comes. And right before this show started, we just saw that the yuan got devalued today by the Chinese government. So, you know, everybody's banking on the yuan replacing the dollar as the reserve currency, and here it's taking a nosedive. So that should interest a lot of people what that does with the markets. But today's show is the conclusion of the Anthony Patch Hangouts that we didn't get to conclude because we had problems with the video that last feed. And this one is called the Helix Nebula, and it's got all kinds of good visual aids and stuff like that. And we'll comment as we go through this, but we wanted to wrap up because Anthony did such a great job bringing all this information out, and we had such a fun time talking about it. It's like a Scooby-Doo investigation, you know, in the Mystery Machine with Anthony Patch. And it was it's a mind-blowing stuff that blew up on the internet after we got going with this series. And other people ran with it, and that's great because it's, you know, everybody needs to have know. Even some pastors got out there and started getting into talking about this CERN-related material. So we'll just kick it over to Chris, and I'm going to highlight my box over on her so that we make sure we get that presentation without it bouncing around, jumping back and forth. All right.
Okay. You see that okay?
Yeah, it looks good.
Yeah, so we're going to be talking about a few things to try to, I mean, it's really time consuming to put all of these pieces together, to do the research, to, you know, put some things that Anthony quoted to help us to understand these complex things with the computers, the quantum computers, CERN, the hybrid clouds, the businesses merging together. And so that, you know, is going to be part of what today's show is, to touch on these things. And if anybody's interested in any of these things that we're talking about, there's going to be lots of links in the description box that you can check out on that too. And we'll be talking about some predictive programming. Tim went to watch a movie that just came out yesterday. And so we're going to touch on a few things that really, when you think about it, these things really will wake you up once you see the predictive programming and the symbolism and all of the things that are attached to this system in the world that we're going to be talking about too. Funny thing, before its news posted, did MIBs kill Anthony Patch over the Hadron Collider leaks? Yes. anyway, I think that he did contact them to let them know that he is still alive and kicking, as he says. And he's doing really well, and he's doing a lot of things that God called him to do. And it's just amazing how God moves in people's lives. You know, like with Tim and his ebook, God has really moved through him, and it's a way to get messages out and information out to people too that haven't, that aren't plugged into the internet or these things that they could actually, you know, share with loved ones, family members, people that aren't awake or anything like that. So it's just a good way to get started on those things to get it out in the world on paper too. So Anthony said, you know, I asked him about the cloud and he said the merging of science data with business data, the data generated by CERN is transmitted and accessible via the Energy Services Network 5, ESnet 5, and he's referred to it in many of his books. If you want his books, you can go to his website or Amazon and find Diamonds 2048. And what was the name of the other book, Tim?
Let's see. Well, he's not going to finish Coalescence, but he wrote Covert Catastrophe, which was, that should be right on Amazon, the Covert Catastrophe one, which was a great read. And it introduced all the science behind the fictional story that was in there. And so that's what got me. I read that and then I got in contact with Anthony Patch and then this whole thing blew up on our hangouts to getting all this in-depth information with Chris and Anthony, you know, really going deep on all these issues and opening up a treasure trove of information for other people to go investigate on their own. So that was what kicked it off.
Yeah. And, you know, the quantum computer is not the same as the computer that we use. It is it's a different type of computer that controls the LHC. And it's, you know, this computer in reality can run everything on this planet eventually. And so those are some of the things that Anthony, you know, talked about on several of the shows that he has out there. And if you Google Anthony Patch and CERN, I'm sure you'll find a lot of his shows. He did quite a bit of them. And the Helix Nebula at work, CERN LHC use CASE. And so this is just something showing that they use this. It's kind of very complicated to understand every facet to this, and especially things that we can't see about the quantum computer. We can see things about how the computer system started with the Department of Defense here and how it progressed and then, you know, see who invented the internet and how that took off. And then they had writers that wrote languages that they used. And then they connect this information, you know, with the hybrid clouds, the quantum, not the quantum computer, but this is the separate computer. There is private clouds and then so anyway, this data is like sharing information. I think the Trans-Pacific Partnership has a lot to do with this, with all of these connections with businesses and connecting these things and connecting businesses and information, opening up sharing information with DNA, you know, the computers and just different things that they're sharing in order to work on these projects that they're doing at CERN. So the first computers, you know, the internet began the development of electronic computers in the 1950s. The Department of Defense awarded contracts as early as 1960s. And this was packet network systems and the developments, it was called ARPANET. But since 2000, cloud computing has come into existence. So cloud computing is a little bit different and there's a lot of networks and this is, you know, like I said before, this is a lot different than the quantum computer. It's not connected to the computers that we use. In the early 2008, NASA's Open Nebula Enhanced in the Reservoir, a European Commission-funded project, became the first open-source software for deploying private and hybrid clouds for the Federation of Clouds. On their Open Nebula Plan page, they have a NASA Open Government Plan, and this agency is to reach the heights to reveal the unknown to what we do and learn and benefit all humankind, is what they say. the keys words in this vision are to reveal the unknown, make lives better on Earth, our home planet. So I put the link below if you want to. And they said transparency and openness were written into our DNA more than 50 years ago with the original Space Act that established the agency in 1958. So if you want to read more on that, that's below. But something real interesting that I wanted to touch on too here with Tim was Maxwell's demon and how it's tied to the computer and how that came about and how that thought process is, so that way we can connect a few things with the computer back then and how these things opened up to try to understand connections and things like that. But Maxwell Demon is tied to the NASA, the cloud nebula, cloud computing, daemon computing, meaning old Greek myth of demons, the Apache license, Berkeley, CERN, John Hopkins University, JPL, Linux, and many federal organizations in other countries that are uniting. So Maxwell's thought demon is a thought experiment created by the physicist James Clerk Maxwell, which he suggested how the second law of thermodynamics could hypothetically be violated. In the thought experiment, a demon controls a small door between two chambers of gas. As individual gas molecules approach the door, the demon quickly opens and shuts the door so the molecules can pass from one chamber to the other, and fast molecules pass into the other chamber because faster molecules are hotter. The demon's behavior causes one chamber to warm up as the other cools, thus increasing the entropy and violating the second law of thermodynamics. Because if you think about it, whatever's controlling this cat, like some of these hot, if you think of hot and cold, and these things are moving at different paces, some faster than the other, and the demon knows exactly how fast each one of them are moving and how fast, where they're going, every directions that they're moving at the same time in order to know when to open up the door. So that's quite interesting.
Yeah, it actually makes me think of just that. If you go back to that picture for a second, if you look on the left, both boxes are pink, and on the right, one's pink and one's blue, and the blue is the cooling down one where the entropy is being lost. And I went and I thought, about the fire and ice rituals they've been doing, when they were doing the ice bucket challenge, and also the kids lighting themselves on fire. And the separating of the two into hot and cold. And it just makes me think, it's a parallel to the occult controlling conditions in matter. So just one of my thoughts.
Yeah. It's a good thought. Daemon computing in multitasking computer operating systems. A daemon is a computer program that runs as a background process rather than being under it the direct control of a interactive user. The term daemon computing was coined by the programmers of MIT Project Mac. They took the name from Maxwell Demon. So they took this name from Maxwell Demon. So this is where they got it from. An imaginary being from a thought experiment that constantly works in the background, sorting molecules.
These are the jokers that I was always talking about that are tripping out on DMT and talking to their little elf. Anthony calls them the clockwork elves on the other side. And and this is MIT, and you don't think that they're doing DMT up there making little things like Maxwell's demon.
Yeah. It's interesting because the UNIX system that's tied to Berkeley inherited this terminology too. And Maxwell Demon is consistent with Greek mythology interpretation of a daemon as a supernatural being working behind the background with no particular bias towards good or evil. And so, their motto actually is that daemon came before demon and it's not good or bad, which that's not the case because the actual term for it,
I think it's actually Kabbalistic. I think it's a Kabbalistic belief, isn't it? That a daemon could be good or bad. Isn't that something from the Jewish mysticism, I think? Go ahead.
Yeah, I think it came way before, though, from India.
Okay.
From way back. But Berkeley software distribution, the OS family is Unix, and this is their logo. Is they wanted to use like a, they call it the Christian demon.
Christian demon. Jeez, these guys.
So NASA uses the Open Nebula, and their operating system is Linux, and their logo is a penguin. And the licensing and the server, you know, is all of it is Apache license. And there was 8 people that actually founded that. Now CERN used to use Open Nebula, but they use OpenStack now, and it's written in Python language. You can look that up to see the guy who wrote the Python language.
Yeah, I know there's time. I know about these languages. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so this was, it's interesting, you know, the times that we're in and all these things that are coming out and just, you know, looking at things. I wasn't familiar with all these things, so I thought I would kind of go into this, you know, and show a little bit about these things and about the writers who, you know, write this, and, you know, you can look them up and kind of, so you can get familiar with it at least, because it's a lot to get familiar
with. Well, Harry Potter spoke in Parseltongue, which is a serpent language, to talk to the basilisk. So these guys speak in Python to talk to the box, or the you know, the black box here. Well, this one's a red box, so that's the Satan cube or the Lucifer cube. Go ahead.
Yeah, we got more on the cube later too.
Oh no.
Here's the just the logo again for Apache software, and you know, their copyright disclaimer and software licenses. It just kind of shows you, you know, what their logo is there. Now, the interesting thing that we did on the last show with Anthony was I really wish that we had his audio, because he had so much great information. But the Helix Nebula, the science cloud, big science teams up with big business. And this is about cloud computing. And this company, actually, if you look it up, they have a video. I posted that, I think, below. And CERN and the Helix Nebula, because CERN is tied to this company, EMBL is tied to this company, and ESA, the European Space Agency, and Volcanic Research. And so it's really interesting that all of these things are tied together, and then they're connected together now through this big, more, you know, computer system and the clouds and the communication, and they have private systems. And then you got the quantum computer that's running the LHC. So, you know, which it can, you can insert phosphorus and elements and different things inside of that computer as well. CERN is the European Organization for Nuclear Research. CERN is the birthplace of the worldwide internet. It has 22 member states, with Pakistan and Turkey being associate members. Israel is the first and currently only non-European country granted full membership. And one of the things that Anthony said that was real interesting about CERN was that antimatter will be produced in greater quantities, and strangelets are intended to replace nuclear warheads, and they will be the most explosive substances and most dangerous weapon in the world. And he explains how they can flow through to the center of the planet. But, you know, one thing that he mentioned too was that this could bring in the New World Order system with this type of power. So we have this type of power. We have new computer systems helping them get to their goal and their challenge, because CERN's goal is to open a portal. That is their goal. There was two students that were, they say it was an accidental drowning of the two, but actually, they were killed for writing about portals and dimensions and writing papers with mathematical. They were writing all of these things out, showing information, and they were both killed, in my opinion. But I mean, I just don't see how it's possible that these two brilliant students could have died. But that is their goal. And So Anthony Patch calls it coalescing of events in the month of September, spiritually, physics, cosmology, and religious-wise. The date September 23rd, 2015 keeps reappearing, and we're not saying that anything's going to happen that day. I don't think that the rapture is going to happen that day. I don't think that we will know that because the Bible says that, and nobody knows the day or the hour. But I do think that there is something going on with the movies doing all of this predictive programming on that date. So, you know, movies talking about the abyss, the portals, there's such a, so much of that coming out. And then on September 27th, Legos is releasing their game Dimensions, and there's a portal in that game. And here's a picture of it. But, so, you know, they have kids, video games, toys, and there's like so many of them. That's just what's coming out. I mean, it's so much predictive programming going on with children right now, and there is adults as well, but it's growing very quickly.
Yeah, they were, I guess, that leftovers program about the 2% of the population are missing, and it's a program about after the rapture, and all these shows are coming out about this time period, and it's like, you know how long you have to actually have these things in production before you got them in the can and then you have them into the mainstream media cycle. And I really have a big problem with Hollywood orchestrating all these end time movies and events and all their videos and stuff. It's just, you can't trust them for anything, and they're going to be part of the end times deception. So why are they involved so much in putting out all this rapture movie propaganda? You know, so the point is, we don't know a time when this is going to happen, and that's what we're told. And the point is to always be looking and always be ready. Just like the bride with the oil and the lamps, the five brides with the oil and the lamps versus the ones without the oil and the lamps. And you're always supposed to be ready, you know, and that's the mentality to have. And but it is interesting. A lot of people will be deceived by whatever they're doing, and we don't know exactly yet, but it's coming up quick on us. So go right ahead.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, CERN, I think it's six stories underground. Alchemy works way differently than it does above ground. It's, you know, below, as above, so below. And it's the hugest magnet ever. You know, it's the biggest magnet in the whole world. And so, you know, clouds have magnets too. And then, so everything is like electric, you know, these helix nebulas. And we're not really understanding how all that works, but you know, NASA does, JPL does, and they're a cult. JPL is, they're a cult. And that's how, you know,
NASA they suppress started. This. And this is the problem I have with all of history and all the scientific, the people who worship science, they purposely put in our public school systems evolution, knowing that evolution isn't real. And they purposely put in the a gravitational model of physics, knowing that there's a plasma model. All along, electromagnetic plasma model. So they purposely keep information suppressed for the group, well, whatever you want to call these people, Illuminati, 1%, you know, Satan serpents, whatever you want to call them. The point is, don't have us, you know, they purposely deceive on purpose for their own benefit. But you can go right ahead.
Yeah, I mean, even Anthony said that they're seeking interdimensional portals and or gateways, and one of the ways is by using sound, the tools, in addition to electricity and magnetic fields. And they do this by using sound and vibration to augment their high-tech instruments to open up portals as done in the ancient times. And that's where, you know, Anthony and I used to collaborate on that and talk about sound and vibration, toroidal fields, and all of those interesting things. So
yeah, we never did get into the Mozart and the magic flute that got him killed, his play The Magic Flute, that was revealing sound and what the occult knows about sound, and he was revealing their stuff, and that got him killed. But
yeah, you know, people are hearing sounds, you know, around the world from CERN. They're hearing you know, sounds underneath the ground. I heard a California, heard it a few times, but, you know, and NASA, they record sounds coming from Saturn and its moons and,
well, they would record sound in CERN also. You remember that? The music of CERN, and before the guys were dancing around and they're acting all crazy, doing their little
The happy dance.
Yeah, before they started doing the wine and cheese party dances in CERN, they were recording the music of CERN, which was, I thought, they're very strange characters. And our Whippet guy that we liked a lot, the first artist, resident artist that we enjoyed with CERN. I digress. You go right ahead.
Yeah, you know, and Anthony also says, you know, gravimetric waves appear to be creating earthquakes and reactivating volcanoes. And, you know, there's a direct correlation between the superconducting magnets and the LHC and the magnetic fields being generated by the accelerated particles.
We really didn't even get into the terraforming aspects of the strangelets on the core, which happen above 13 TeV, and, you know, all these other things. We really just touched on it.
Yeah, and in September, I guess that's supposed to be 13 TeVs then.
I think it's actually more than that, I think. I forgot, actually. I have to check.
Yeah, so this is their volcanic research they're doing that's tied to CERN. And, you know, the ESA has some teams and cameras called OSIRIS. OS is operating systems or software, and IRIS means the eye. And Ptolemy is the Egyptians, you know, they were the last ones. And they have a team called Ptolemy also. And then when they landed, when NASA, they have this camera probe that landed on this asteroid a little while back. They named parts of it Happy, Anubis, Aten, Hathor, you know, just Egyptian gods. So all of these companies revolve around calling all their machines, teams, cameras after, you know, ancient gods and stuff. And this is about OSIRIS-REx. It'll travel near Earth asteroid called Bennu. The Bennu bird is Thoth, and it's like a spirit. And but they're calling this asteroid the Bennu. If you look up the Bennu bird, you'll see what it is. And anyway, so they're going to bring a sample back to Earth for study, they say, and the mission is scheduled to launch in late 2016. As planned, the spacecraft will reach its asteroid target in 2018 and return a sample in 2023 is what they say. We'll see about that. But ESA also has a big conference coming up this month, and they say it's easier to see what is disappearing than what is coming into being, yet this limitation can be overturned and become a resource. So I'll put the link below if you want to look at everything that they said about this, you know, upcoming conference that they have. And I just wanted to point out the lasers that are pointing to volcanoes to gather information from them. This is Susan Duclos from Pipeline News. She has a video and pictures of this laser going to this volcano in Japan, Sakurajima, I guess that's how you say it.
Sakurajima.
Sakurajima. And so ESA also is with ESO working groups, and this thing that they did in 2008 was called Galactic Populations, Chemistry, and Dynamics, and they show them going into the Milky Way, which I'm going to touch on a hole that's in the Milky Way later. But this is the other company CERN's partner with or merged with or working with, EMBL. And these are hermaphrodites. Is that how you say it, Tim?
Hermaphrodites are just hermaphrodites. People who have male and female sexual organs. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they are protesting against this lab. for their rights to choose who what they want to do with their own body. So I just wanted to point that out. And then here's some stuff on volcanic gods. Here's Bess of Egypt. The National Geographic did Indonesia's Ring of Fire and volcanic gods. Hephaestus is the Olympian god of fire, metalworking, building, and fine arts, known as Tubal Cain and Ptah. I am Hotep. The Freemasons worship the craftsmen, and they're masons. And so here's his symbol, which is alchemy. And this is the ladder, which represents the Milky Way. And here's the pillars on the Freemasons Masonic board.
Yeah, that picture of the anvil and the guy with the hammer makes me think of Thor, you know, the god of thunder, lightning, all that kind of stuff, because he brings a hammer down and then the sparks fly. And it's kind of an adaption of that. That's some kind of Masonic adaption to Thor and this workman.
Yeah, like his magic hammer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The next couple of photos I wanted to show was from Holographic Galaxy blog, and it shows their actual clouds and double helixes and magnetic tubes. This is Sagittarius A and B. This is the Milky Way here. It's in the black hole is in the center of the galaxy, but this is a double helix pigtail molecule cloud, further supports a living cell galaxy in fractal biocosmology. I thought it was an interesting picture there.
And you also see these circles within circles in a lot of movies where they're spinning and creating a time distortion of some sort. So I think it's interesting that they keep showing these in all their models.
This is kind of a video that I got from Prometheus, and it kind of shows what it would look like if the stars, you know, it's going around and those are like electric shocks. And here's the pigtail molecule cloud. It's the most clear, detailed, and largest DNA-like double helix molecule cloud discovered.
You know, it's funny. It's actually shaped like Jack and the Beanstalk, too, kind of. The whole, you know, the sliding down, how they slide down the different, you know, it has different turns and bends going down. Interesting.
Here's the Helix Nebula Science Clouds logo. And the Helix Nebula is located in the constellation Aquarius. There's a reason why they use that logo for sure. The Helix Nebula has sometimes been referred to as the Eye of God in pop culture, as well as the Eye of Sauron. Aquarius is identified as Gula, the Great One, in Babylonian star catalogs, and it represents the god E holding an overflowing vase. E is inky. E also, if I don't know if you can see this, I got a bigger picture of it. He represents the turtle. And the Kushites also, their symbol is the turtle also. But interesting that he represents Aquarius in ancient history.
You'll see this is Enki, EA is Enki. And for those who are in the video game playing world, they know that all the sports games are called EA from EA Sports. So Enki Sports, you know, when it's in the game.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, that's tied in there. I mean, nobody probably questions, you know, why do you tie gods into your stuff? You know, why, you know, they don't talk about those things. They'll name things, the gods, and they'll have stuff about them in the computer programming stuff, and they'll touch on demons and things, but they'll never come out right out and talk about it probably. So anyway, this is from 1125, supposedly, and the Kaduru limestone. This is a Babylonian. These are stargates here. And then a lot of the Egyptian tombs had this too. And then they had water pools that people could bathe in that would look like this too, with like metal elements coming from the mountains and the Nile River. And here's Aquarius constellation, and it's between Capricornus and Pisces. There's the way the stars have changed over time. There's a difference when, you know, where they're located at is in the Milky Way, but he's called the water cup barrier. These are some nebulas. These are where they're located at the ring. These were similar to each other. This is when I was reading about the writings on them. They're similar. And that's why I put these. There's a whole bunch of nebulas and they're all in different constellations. And I put a link below. You'll see the pictures of them and where they're located at if you're interested in that. This is the Cat's Eye Nebula in Draco constellation. Draco used to be where the North Star was. And now that's Ursa Major in that location. This is the optical image of the Cat's Eye Nebula surrounding Halo. And this is the Helix Nebula, Ring Nebula in Lyra. It's called this one's the Dumbbell Nebula in Vulpecula.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the Crab Nebula and in Taurus, which this is one of the most interesting ones because of the story of Osiris and how the crab ate his phallus. And it's in Taurus. And Taurus is connected to, this is a engraved hourglass nebula. Let me show you this one real quick. Saturn Nebula, this is in Aquarius also. And this one isn't as similar as the other ones. I just put it there so you could see. And because of the rings in it, they call it the Saturn. But this one is in Musca, which means fly. And this is one of the most interesting nebulas out there. And it kind of looks like the two circles with the phallus in the middle. But here, this is the actual picture, and it looks like an eye in the middle. And Musca means fly, but it used to mean a Latin B in Apis. And I know that the Latin B is located on Taurus, and so there's some changes in the constellations. I'm not an expert on it, but I do know that Musca the fly used to be, you know, called the Apis. So the Apis is the bull. It is a kind of bull that's tied to Osiris. And, you know, Osiris, like I said before, OS for software and operating software and Iris's eye. And he used to be called Osiris Apis, and a temple of Serapis was located in Egypt to show that change when they did those sacrificing of the bulls. But in this movie, I'll touch on a little bit more of the pictures later, but this Hourglass Nebula is on the CERN laboratory in the film Angels and Demons.
You know, it's funny if you just keep linking that picture, that you basically have the, is it the BMW logo or is it the Audi logo with the loop and sixes?
The Audi.
Is it Audi? So if you just connected another one there, you'd be getting your little Audi, your rings, your little sixes and stuff. Kind of interesting.
Yeah, this is just to say that, you know, what NASA says about the planetary nebula are actually the remains of stars that once looked like our own sun. These stars spend most of their lives turning hydrogen into helium in massive runaway nuclear fusion reactions in their cores. In fact, this process of fusion provides all the light and heat that we get from our sun, according to NASA, which is really interesting. This image taken by the Very Large Array of the ground-based telescopes at radio wavelength shows a bright source at the center of the Milky Way that is thought to surround a black hole. From observations of stars in orbit around the galactic center, it is concluded that there is indeed a supermassive black hole in this region, approximately 4 million times the mass of the sun. the structure known as the Galactic Center radio arc, upper left, is the described as the hot plasma flowing along the lines of the magnetic field. And I have a couple of more pictures. NASA's Chandra detects record-breaking outbursts from Milky Way's black hole. The supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy called Sagittarius A is estimated to contain about 4.5 million times the mass of the sun, just like I said before. Here's another picture of it. And this is from NASA's record. They are able to determine at the Okay, wait a minute. This is what Anthony said, I think. From this NASA record, they are able to determine at what power level the Large Hadron Collider would need to operate in the opening of the interdimensional portal, thus the upgrading the magnets. So Anthony is the one who said that.
Yeah, this was the when we were discussing the Markarian 421 show, and the beam coming out of the center. This is also how his covert catastrophe book opens up, dealing with this beam coming out of I think it was Markarian 421.
Yeah, here's the Sagittarius A. So it's in the center of these circles here that they have, you know. And here's the hole attacking a star. This is like a animated man-made picture. It's not like the other ones that I showed. The LHC produces secretron energy, same as MBHs, same as taking place at the northern pole of Saturn. Synchrotron energy will be used to create Birkeland currents to establish an electric helical-shaped plasma conduit connecting the LHC to its southern pole of Saturn. It will do this by first linking the dwarf planet Ceres, presently orbited by the Dawn satellite, and exhibiting twin bright lights from one of its surface craters. Testing of links and alignments is taking place between Ceres and the LHC in preparation for the projection of the synchrotron energies to Ceres. From there, these Birkeland currents will link over to the southern pole of Saturn itself, like play and pull, eight ball in the corner pocket. Anthony Patch.
And this is probably a good place for me to mention as she's getting into these other areas here. This is what I saw yesterday when I went to look at the Fantastic Four movie. This is exactly what was occurring in that movie, and I'm sure she has some pictures that will probably that show these Birkeland currents and what we've talked about. It's probably 65 right there. Your slide 65, I think, is the one.
Oh, this one?
Yeah.
Was that what it looked like?
Yeah, that's exactly what it was in the Fantastic Four movie, the linking the Dr. Doom world that they used to transport through the portal to and the Earth. And it had the big donut right in the middle. It was composed of a stone ring of just collected rock in that the donut, as we called it with the previous Iron Man donut examples. And it was connecting the two worlds exactly like that, a beam shooting up and a beam shooting down. And it was collapsing the Earth into a black hole into that other world. That's what the purpose of that is, directly in the Fantastic Four movie, exactly as Anthony Patch had talked about this connection. So if you want to see it, you can go see it.
Tim, you didn't take a picture of it in the movie theater?
Yeah, me and my bootleg movies, I'll tell you. No, I didn't take a picture of it. I was just watching and going, yeah, we talked about that. And that's that this is supposedly what occurs. Now, CERN, when it gets above the level and they do the directed energy Birkeland current type of shot with the alignment. Well, we were covering all these things about the different what was it, the Dawn mission and some of the other ones that were passing by certain planets, and the Ceres one, we were talking about the two spots. And the last one we didn't cover was the Pluto one that just happened. And so basically with the quantum computer, it can calculate all the alignments to get this what's the term that they like to use? Yeah, what's the ancient world that they want? The golden age, the golden
age of Aquarius.
The age of Aquarius, golden age. They want to get that same planetary alignment by connecting the group. Since you can't get the planets in line, you can connect them though. With the Birklands, and that's what they're trying to do. And the Saturn connection is the one where you get the demonic kind of breaking out of jail. And that was what was shown in the Fantastic Four, the Doctor Doom character coming through the portal into this world. So what is going to come through this portal? Anthony was talking about that the September shot would be the one that would stabilize a stable conduit, you know, with the southern connecting point of Saturn, which allows the travel of these spirits and things like that. That's kind of what was shown in Fantastic Four, and we've seen that in some of the other movies. A lot of CERN symbology I've been watching, the movie Insurgent that you can go and get at Redbox right now has a ton of the CERN circles all through large parts of that. That's a post-apocalyptic kind of recreating humanity after the apocalyptic event. And the Maze Runner movie coming out talks about the scorch or the burned sky and existing outside of their little mazes to, you know, reintroduce humanity. It's crazy stuff. It's the crazy stuff of the occult world. And you're seeing it right in front of you. And but this is actually shown. This is all the stuff that we're looking at here shown in these movies. So if you want to see this is in Fantastic Four. And since our last show, the Terminator movie also had a lot of the black goo and other stuff that we discussed also related to CERN. But go right ahead, Chris.
Okay. Just like you were talking about, Tim, to reach the southern pole of Saturn, Lucifer with his Birkeland current, that is a set of currents that flow along the geomagnetic field lines connecting the Earth's magnetosphere to the Earth's high latitude ionosphere. It is then linked to Jacob's ladder. They hope to achieve the turning back the clock, eternity, and reign as gods and goddesses with their Lucifer. These currents are all over the cosmos. Every time CERN fires up, it changes the magnetosphere. Here's some more.
Do you have pictures of your the angels and demons video that you were talking about?
Oh yeah, I was about
you're
to
showing
show
that
those.
Later. Okay.
No, I'm
When you get to it.
Yeah. Just real quick. This is the H8. We're talking. We've done a lot of videos on H+ and the 8 and the merging of DNA, and that's what it represents. The Birkeland currents, and we talked about Ptah and the DNA of the ancients, and this is what that is all about to them. Is this DNA and then you know this in the autumn equinox coming up. This is the Milky Way in the Egyptian hieroglyphs. This is Nut, but she represents the Milky Way. And we know that there is a big hole there where Sagittarius A is. And she also represents Isis and Hathor, and they're kind of like spirit beings. But this is, you know, how they would go on their solar boat and go through the Milky Way, and they would do, you know, in their hieroglyphs and in the Book of the Dead, they would talk about how they would shape shift and they would do these things through their tuning forks and sound and perfect harmony. So this is kind of what CERN is mentioned, you know, that they're doing, so, you know, sort of the same thing as this ancient technology. These are the stars around that center of the Milky Way there, and here's that picture there again. But here's the angels and demons, Tim. Here's the pictures. Mm-hmm. I watched the movie Angels and Demons. Did you watch it?
No, I want to watch it. I totally, it was a 2009 movie, and I think you can get it on, what is it, Amazon Plus or whatever. You can download it for, it's about $2.99 or something.
I think I rented it for $3.99 on mm-hmm. iTunes, but I snapped some pictures from it, and then I got some off the internet. But this is the ring the Pope wore, and then they used the hammer and some kind of thing to make a cross on the front of it when he died. And here he is, the dead. He kind of looks like Pope John Paul, but here he is with his red shoes. And after that scene, you know, the Pope dies, and then they go to the Large Hadron Collider in this movie. And it's really gross. I can't even tell you. It's the guy, he loses his eye, and, yeah. you know, and
they like being gross.
Yeah. So the Illuminati comes in and they steal this antimatter, and they have to find it in a certain time before the battery dies.
Mm.
And four cardinals are kidnapped, and they use these angels, depending on where they were facing or pointing. Tom Hanks played the professor, and he didn't get to finish his book because he studied about the Illuminati, but the Vatican had pages that he was not able to see to finish his book.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have these angels here that were clues for him. Here he is in the Vatican Library. And this was one of the pages that the woman that he was with that worked at CERN, they took this page. And then the Vatican gave it to him at the end of the movie. Sorry, I didn't mean to spoil that for you.
No. I mean, it's for those who want to see these movies. This one looks very interesting. With what we know now, looking back at 2009, would actually kind of be fun to watch it that way.
I know. Does anyone ever wonder why they hide all these things at the Vatican Library? There's so much information that the world has never seen.
Yeah.
So much stuff.
Well, as I was saying on my podcast the other day, I was saying the Jesuit order is the society of another Jesus, as said in Galatians 1. The Society of Jesus is who that's the name, that's a technical name, but they teach another gospel. So that's why I was lambasting them the other day on Galatians 1, and, you know, as an indictment against this church who hides everything, steals and lies and assassinates and all kinds of stuff to keep their secrets for the 1%.
Yeah, and in this movie, when the antimatter explodes, it looks just like the Helix Nebula.
Wow. Jeez.
So, and then here's some more pictures. Did you want me to go over any of these other pictures anymore?
Or? No, this is the Fantastic Four that I saw yesterday. And, if you know that series, the ones that Rockman to the right, one's the fire guy, one's the invisible girl, and then the guy on the left is the doctor, I forget what his name was, but his stretch, you know, he can stretch, you know. So they got their powers from going through the portal. That's what happened. They were altered by the power on the other side. Yeah, 87 is what I saw. I believe that's the, if you're looking for what I saw in this movie, I think it's your slide down below 87.
Oh, this right here?
Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, that's you see the donut in the middle and the beams coming up from the bottom, and then there's ones coming from the top. And if you round out that bottom there, you got the bell look that we showed before with her Egypt, when Chris did her Egyptian symbolism, showing this in the ancient symbolism, the bell plasma in the bottom cone and the bell one above, and the connecting in the toroidal field, which is the donut in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Now, was this guy, he was in the movie.
That's him. That's the Dr. Doom character that comes through the portal. So it just makes you wonder what's coming through the portal.
Yeah. He wants to rule the world, right?
Yeah. Well, he wants to destroy the Earth. He wants to save his planet and destroy the Earth at the same time. So.
Yeah, you see that field.
That's they keep showing that over and over from the X-Men, the first X-Men movie. That was that they did that on the Statue of Liberty up at the in the torch on the Statue of Liberty. Did Lucifer's Lucifer's light, you know?
Yeah. This is the one that's coming out, I think, in 2017. It's called Reign of Unicron.
Wow. Look at that. Behind them, the Stargate portal.
Yeah.
It's exactly like the Stargate movie with the, yeah.
Yeah, and if you look online at the Stargate of Iraq, you'll see the one that they found there. There's pictures of that. It looks a lot like that.
Mm-hmm. And that gives you more reason why we went into Iraq. It doesn't really have anything to do with helping the Iraqis.
Yeah. Here is the guy. He's holding that cube.
Yeah, there it is.
That's the older Transformer movie.
Yeah, yeah. I wonder what the G stands there for.
Google?
No, it is Google. Yes, I think it's Google. The Freemasons and Google.
Grandmaster.
Grandmaster Google.
Yep, so that's his little magic cube that he... So, you know, I didn't find that video, but I was looking for the one that was so good. I saw it in the past with the Transformers, and they decoded it. Yeah. And all the messages on the chalkboard with the riding the donkey. Mm-hmm. And everything in that movie was just like biblical, like unfolding things. And at the end, they talked about how they came here because we were from them, like our DNA or something.
Right. Well, that's the whole panspermia thing, but that's also the fallen angels mating with women and giving the that's what the Illuminati think. They think that they have the DNA of the angels, the fallen angels, and that's who they think they are. That's why when you watch any of these shows, the angel symbolism is also always a reference to the Illuminati. What do you want to say? The DNA lines of the Illuminati here, they picture themselves with wings, that they were fell, that their fathers were the fallen ones, and that they had they deserve the rule because the fallen ones, Lucifer's kingdom ruled here first before Adam intruded. So this is how they see it.
Yeah, I saw that movie Jupiter Rising, and it was the guy lost his wings. Cain actually was, he fell in love with a girl whose name was Jupiter, and she was supposedly own the universe or something. And
she was the queen bee. The queen bee.
Yeah.
Queen bee. Oh, boy.
So here's the father time. This is Saturn, Kronos. Yeah. It's just a mythological picture, and but just to show that, you know, there has always been time. There is, it's, you know, in the world, there's always been a computer program that we don't probably know everything about that's from a long time ago. Those computer programs, you know, never went away. Here's a Transformers children's cartoon when he gets the black cube or the cube.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then here he is now as the leader, looks like the Pope hat.
Yeah, he actually looks like the Red Skull from the Avengers, well, the Captain America movies.
Yeah, here's this picture of the two that died, and then two Marines also died, and these were the young students that talked about CERN and parallel universes, and so they were speaking out on the knowledge that they had, and these were the two that died. So very sad.
There's a lot of nice people out there that have stumbled across this stuff without knowing what they stumbled across.
Yeah, I think that some of their papers are on DocStock or something that they did. But remember this, Tim? This just came out.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, we've been tracking the Kali thing and the Shiva thing since Kathmandu, watching it travel around with the tattoo festivals. And here they go and do this of all things. And people definitely caught on to this one. I mean, this definitely lit up the internet after we were kind of early on this story on the Facebook page. But Yeah, I mean, what purpose is there to put the goddess of destruction, Kali, you know, on in the middle of New York City after Obama's famous, oh, a nuke could go off in downtown New York speech, you know?
Yeah, it's very weird. I think that these people in power do these messages. They do it for a reason. Well, and I know CERN, look at CERN has Kali, you know, here's the CERN symbol here.
Yeah, Kali and Shiva go together. I mean, they really, you don't really separate the two of them. They kind of work together. Kali dances on Shiva to wake him up. So she's kind of the destroyer and Shiva kind of starts recreating. It's the, I think you're going to talk about thermodynamics and stuff like that. But that's kind of what this is, the ancient Hindu kind of version of matter being changed and created. But, you know, that was why that Maxwell's cube with the stopping entropy thing was very interesting, because that's separating matter and stopping entropy. That's pretty wild.
Yeah. And well, you know, the demons or the fallen angels, they're known as male and female, you mm-hmm. know, mm-hmm. and so they're actually one deity. It's very confusing, but
they do it on purpose.
Here's the other, I don't know if anybody could see this well, but they have the monkeys, the turtle, the lion, and the eagle. And this is interesting, you know, some people have the rhesus monkey DNA, and then the turtle represents the Kushites, and which is interesting, you know. And then we have the lion, which was supposedly Juno's brother that was killed by Hercules. So it's just, and then the eagle, which represents Zeus or Jupiter. So I just find that interesting that they would use animals, because we know that the end times and these, you know, there's a lot to do with nature and on that side of the fence, you know, with not that anything's wrong with nature, but there's another way that they view like worshiping nature, the elite do. And it has to do with DNA and animals and shape-shifting from way back when. That's written in many tablets. And, you know, so that's interesting with that. And there's some demons too, Tim, that I looked up. Mm-hmm. I don't have it's called Utica. They're a sibling of the Anunnaki. Mm-hmm. And there's hieroglyphics of them, like they have lion heads. They're like part animal, part human. And the mm-hmm. Bible has their name in it. Wow. And so, yeah, so I thought I would say that because some of them have like claw feet. And the Bible mentions these types of demons because there's different types and how they're invisible and you know, about their DNA and stuff like that. And, you know, there's old books written in different languages about, you know, different things with DNA and stuff like that. But definitely something has happened with DNA over time.
Well, that's why you hear me, you know, some people might get tired of me getting carried away with the whole Catholic Church and the Jesuits, but they really are the only network that has been like in place in every country for forever. And they've been suppressing the educational systems, what goes in libraries, rewriting history. And then they got all the archives, you know, for themselves and for their elite buddies. And, you know, yeah, it would be an absolute shock to see how much stuff's been suppressed if you got into those libraries and what a false reality they've created for their own purposes.
Yeah. For sure. I mean, people would be surprised. They hold it from people for a reason. But I put this in my last two videos with Clinton Cowatch and Pastor D. We talked about this, but touch on it again, because I mean, we're talking about all this stuff, and then we have this transhumanist party that has running for the president of the United States of America. And his number one goal is immortality and to conquer death. And Jesus conquered death on the cross. And this is Satan's agenda to bring in the new world order mark of the beast technology, because Satan wants people to be imprisoned in the flesh for eternity. And he tricks people into thinking they can live forever. You know, you could be as your own God, and you could be as gods, like the Bible says. But this is not that he might win or anything, but just to point it out there, you know, what the mindset is of the world, because he thinks that the transhumanism is going to merge with the LGBT and become a one big powerful community, and which is possible. I mean, we're watching things for the end times and things to happen. So, you know, you never know.
Well, with the name like Zoltan Itzvan, he's as American as Barack Obama. So, yeah.
That makes sense. Yeah, that's what I thought when I saw his name. It's like, well,
that's just as American as Barack Obama.
Yeah, Clinton Kowatch, he majored in economics, and we had a lot of interesting talk. And one of the things that he pointed out to me about transhumanism and then immortality and the mark of the beast was, in those days men shall seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And so if he's looking for immortality and they find it with this gold mark of the beast, then this is what the Bible is referring to, were those types of people that mm-hmm. they will seek death and shall not find it, and they'll desire to die, and death shall flee from them.
Mm-hmm.
And in Daniel 2:4-3, it says, "And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave to one another, even as iron is not mixed with clay." And here's a picture of this tattoo. I'm not saying this is going to be the mark of the beast, but I do know gold has something to do with it, because the Bible says it does. Anthony Patch has talked about the quantum computer and gold, and the strongest mm-hmm. storage data in the quantum computer with DNA and gold, utilized with gold. And he certainly knows a lot more about that than I do. But I find it fascinating that he understands a lot of that I don't. And just because, you know, RFID means right of the devil in Latin. Anybody who takes the mark will become part of this quantum computer system, and their soul will belong to Satan. And gold means kephem. It's number 3800 in the Strong's exhaustive concordance. And so the root word is kephem, and it means to be stained. So gold actually translates the word in the Bible. And I do think that that has something to do with the mark of the beast.
Well, in Jewish tradition and in the tradition of sin, that's why they had the scapegoat and the and all that. You had to sacrifice animals that didn't have any blemishes or weren't stained or whatever. You couldn't offer those. You had to offer the pure ones. And so sin was always associated with blemishing, being blemished, you know. So that's interesting that gold means stained.
Yeah, it was interesting, you know, from the Bible, that's what it means. But I have a link to below that talks about gold and atoms and stuff. So it's really interesting if you want to read that. But we know that the Trans-Pacific Partnership, Obama is the leader of that. And this is has a lot to do with the end times, Mark of the Beast, getting control of a world trading system and enslavement. And so this is not a conspiracy. This is actually happening. And, you know, I do believe that we will have the North American Union coming soon. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is getting signed. It's not all the way completely signed, but it should be. This year, you know, this fall actually is from what they're talking about. And that's not going to be good, because we already have GMOs in our food, and we have a lot of things that are wrong with the way the system already is, but this will make it even worse with things being traded not safe here in America. And then this is tied to Obamacare, the internet, a ton of laws, and all kinds of things that we are not privy to know, because there's only been a certain amount of information leaked on this Trans-Pacific Partnership for us to know anything about. And so that's all we can go on is, you know, basically what we have, you know, the corporate leaders, you know, that one of them's going to be Goldman Sachs, you know, and Walmart is part of that. It was, I don't know if it still is, but when I was researching it in depth a long time ago, it was one of the corporate leaders, and they even installed a scanner inside of one of the Walmart stores in Virginia. And you can look that up, you know, like a hand scanner with a RFID scanner. And it talks about Obamacare on the, when you push the buttons and stuff like that. So I find that really weird because, you know, and then you have all these FEMA coffins and camps, and you got this Jade Helm going on. And this is nothing to fearmonger, because I think that it's just part of waking up to the system and what's going on, because we never know what's going to happen. And it's good to be awake and to know the truth and to be watchmen, like God calls us, as you know, he calls us to do that, and to expose the dark. And so, you know, I do believe that I do believe that God will protect his coveted people. I really do, with all of my heart. And I think that having a relationship with Jesus Christ is the most important thing. Because, I mean, we are in these times. The Bible talks about the third temple is in production right now. I just read an article that the red heifer is in production right now, the one. And we have the third temple. The plans are done. The plans are complete to build the third temple. They're finished. And so they're already doing sacrifices. The temple, you can look at the Temple Institute website, and you can look at what they're doing, and you can look at a video about their plans. And
you know, it would make a lot of sense. Pictures from that. It would make a lot of sense to me that to have a transhumanist world, you might as well have a genetically designed red heifer to sacrifice to establish your Antichrist at the third temple. That would fit, you know. Why wait for a normal red heifer when you just do a designer red heifer that goes right along with the whole transhumanist movement? Fits right in.
I know. I mean, it appears that what they've been working on all this time is artificial DNA, anyway. Mm-hmm. You know,
so that's what I'm saying. This is a genetically designer babies. This is designer red heifer.
Yeah, and if the quantum computer stores artificial DNA and it controls the Large Hadron Collider, and if this is the most expensive, most dangerous machine in the world, and it can control the world eventually, from some people's perspectives, then I think that's something to really look out for, is, you know, to not fall into those traps of the world of whatever they're doing with technology.
And well, that's why the last Arnold Schwarzenegger's last Terminator movie really did show you the flipping from Internet 1 to Internet 2, where Skynet takes over, which is the hardwired, CERN-connected, laboratory-connected, university-connected Internet, and the other one goes by the wayside. And but the point was, everybody, you go over to Skynet, you go over to the Hive, and that's a transition I think that you will see based on anything that they do. You know, whenever they flip the switch to go over to that.
Yeah, this, see where they have this on the Temple Institute, Tim? Look at this. They have the this would be where the Ark of the Covenant would go on this, on the foundation stone right there.
Where's the mosque in that picture?
Right here. Like part of, there's a shadow of it, but it's right here. Here's the gold dome right here.
So this is still based off of knocking down the mosque basically through war or something.
Yep, this is the plans from the Temple Institute. They have paid a lot of money for these plans. They have a video of a temple that is pretty interesting, kind of amazing looking. You know, it has where the Ark of the Covenant would go. It has the glass stairs, and you know, it shows like all the pictures of what it looks like.
Seen that. I remember we were looking at that Jerusalem trailer, which showed bombs falling right next to the Dome of the Rock. That was a trailer for a movie that was supposed to come out at the end of this year. I don't know if it's going to be released or not, but you remember that one about the couple that goes for a trip to Jerusalem and gets caught in World War III, basically?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Sorry, I lost my train of thought there. But the Temple Institute has all of these plans, and just interesting how all of these things are playing out, how the politics are changing, the leaders of politics are changing. One of the leaders is all for the temple, and then all these things that are going on here with the Supreme Court and Obama and making Israel an international city.
Yeah,
that's just, you know, it's we're living in these times. I mean, we're watching all of these things play out right now. So
I just been watching Donald Trump and Megyn Kelly fighting. I haven't paid attention to anything else.
You know, he's here in Michigan today. I got neighbors saying I'm gonna go see him. Oh, I'm like, okay.
Go waste your time. Enjoy.
Well, just wanted to say here before we close, and then you say whatever you want to say to Tim, but the only way to heaven is through Jesus Christ, and no other gods or gateway. Jesus is the gate. Anyone who takes the mark will be lost. Satan wants everyone's mind, and he is not God, so he has to use technology to enslave people in the end.
Yeah, amen. That's what he's doing. That's what we're watching. That's what we're reporting. And the followers of Christ need to get serious about repenting, getting into the Bible, getting oil in their lamp, and then praying for the salvation of their family and friends, praying for their neighborhoods, praying for their cities. Because the more prayer that we do, the more that we are able to help people get saved and get into the kingdom. And that's the only reason why Jesus is delaying coming back, is wait for people who have been trapped in the matrix to wake up. And that's what we're doing. That's what we do with the End Times Matrix, is we point out stuff. And it's not just for sensational purpose so you get saved, so that you enter repentance, you get transformed by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, and you're able to walk the walk and talk the talk. And this world will pass away. This matrix will pass away. And that's what, when we were looking at Father Time, it was making me think it had the sickle up there, and when Father Time was sitting in the seat. And I was thinking, yeah, that's like, there's a time when there will be a reaping or a harvesting of souls. And that is the end times, where the tares and the wheat are separated. And tares just means weeds. It just means the weeds and the wheat are separated. The wheat are the ones who believe in Christ, follow Christ, are redeemed. The weeds are the ones who rejected Christ and want to be in the beast system, the Antichrist system. And so when I look at Father Time with the big the sickle, that just means we're in that time of the reaping. And there's a whole section in there called the Grapes of Wrath in Book of Revelation, talks about the blood of those being harvested. And that's, the end times, a very bloody time. And Well, like it said, there's no other time on earth like it. So it's not going to be that devastating. So you can continue waiting. And that was what I was talking on the podcast the other day. You can continue waiting and know all this information and let your flesh talk you out of getting saved, because the flesh doesn't like the things of the spirit and never has, never will. You can't teach the flesh spiritual things. It doesn't like it. It doesn't want to hear it. It can agree with the spiritual things, say, sure, you're right, and then go about its happy little way doing what it's been doing all along. At some point, you have to say, I want to make my decision today to get saved, and I'm going to repent, and I'm going to turn from the matrix, turn from walking in the flesh, turn to sowing to the spirit and getting saved. And it's the gospel that changes the hearts. It's no amount of education, no amount of data or whatever. The gospel that Christ was crucified, he died on the cross to connect us back with the Father through redemption, through admitting that we sinned against the Father, that we're separated from him. He paid the price for us. He covers our sins. And through his free gift of his life for us, we are transformed into a eternal fellowship with Jesus and the Father. And you can stay here in the matrix and end up in hell and be destroyed, or you can accept the free gift and enjoy an eternity without Satan and all his minions messing things up all the time. And so that's the ending of this hangout. I just want to say, all you have to do is call out to the Lord and say, Jesus, I know you're the way, the truth, and the light. There's no way to the Father but through you. I believe on you. I invite you into my heart. I repent of my sins. I turn from my old ways, and now I'm going to walk in the way of the Spirit with you. And that's what you need to do. And if you mean it in your heart when you say that, you're saved. You know, and you're going to avoid the damnation that the rest of the folks who are following, who decide to choose to spend eternity in hell with the fallen angels that have deceived the world. You know, so you don't want to go down that path. And the powerful images, powerful time, CERN, you know, amazing key to the pit, basically, is what we generally call it. It just needs the angel to turn the key, you know. And yeah, maybe Dr. Doom is the one that comes through the portal and he'll flip the switch, you know. I don't know. Yep. But thanks
all
a lot.
That was well said. Thank you, Tim. You know, I just wanted to say too is that Jesus is in the business of changing people's lives and changing people's hearts. And I've seen him change many people. And he's, you know, the Bible says, if you don't ask, you don't have because you don't ask. And so I would just want to encourage people to trust in the Lord and for all of your needs, because we're all sinners and we all, you know, need a Savior. And so if you haven't asked Jesus in your heart, please consider doing that and ask him to and repent of your sins. You know, he wipes our slate clean and he gives everybody a new beginning. And I just praise him, you know, for all the people watching, for all the miracles that he's going to do in all of our lives. Mm-hmm. And for all the people I'm going to see in heaven with me one day.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So this was a culmination of all the great stuff that we got with Anthony Patch, and we were allowed to have a good time with him in fellowship as fellow Christians, discussing science, physics, ancient history, and the Illuminati, New World Order, fallen man, and redeemed man. And we're going to continue with the hangouts as the Lord leads us with different topics or different issues. And Chris, you know, we'll just keep putting out different things. I'm going to get my ebook out here in the next couple weeks, and then we'll proceed from there. So we'll keep pushing forward. And if the rapture happens, the rapture happens, and we're exceedingly happy, you know, because then you don't have to deal with this garbage that we're forced to deal with these fallen leaders in this fallen world. And but we're thankful that everybody's watching us. Appreciate all the nice messages and things, and happy to put out a great amount of information, and hope you enjoy it and share it. And we'll post other ones in the near future. Thank you very much.
Yep. Thanks. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.